Good morning, Amgrove.
Good morning.
Good morning. You guys sound awesome singing, and your faces look radiant. And how about counting our blessings today? Because this week has been great, right?
Yeah.
I pray to God, and I'm hoping that you guys will pray to God that it remains like that the rest of the summer. But you know the reality doesn't. But man, take advantage of what it is and count your blessing that you're in it and you're alive today and you made it to the house of God today. Are you happy?
Yeah.
Man, I want to praise the Lord for everything. And there is nothing as good as starting with a word of prayer. Will you bow with me and pray? Father, Lord, I thank you. And I bless you, God, for who you are, number one. For being sovereign, Father God. And knowing everything from beginning till the end and in between, God.
Yeah.
And you saw it fit, God, that we'll be alive in such a time. We'll be healthy and strong as we can be, Father, Lord, in such a time. And God be in a great nation as it is, Lord. And we pray that God, each and every day before anything, before we look at the world itself, Father God, and join in their chorus sometimes, which can be so, sometimes, Lord, so negative, that God will take our time, Lord, even to count our blessings, Father. And we pray that God will take the time to count them one by one and see how privileged and blessed we are, because indeed, God, you blessed us. And so, Father, Lord, I want to thank you for the day and for the week, God, that you've seen us through, Lord, to this very point. And as we come together as your children, Father, Lord, as Amgrove, Father, we pray that, God, our praises, Father, Lord, our prayers, Father, our focus, Lord, will be geared towards you. And that, Lord, we will put our hearts and minds and our spirit and conscience, Father, Lord, even towards you. To learn, to hear from you, Father God. And I pray that whatever you have for us today, God, that, Lord, it will resonate. Not just for a few hours, Father God, or for a day, but for weeks and years to come. And we pray that, God, we will honor you with our lives. So thank you so much for everything. We bless you, Father God, and we praise you. For our missionaries today, Father God, the Shredders, Father, I pray that, God, you'll bless them and you'll be with them, Father God. Thank you for choosing them, Father. Thank you for enabling them, Lord, even to toil. I know it's not easy, Lord, being in the field with the little resources sometimes, Father God, language barriers, Father God, and other things that come across, Father, Lord, that may hinder, Lord, the spread of the good news. But we know that you work miracles, Father. And that, God, you rejuvenate. And that, God, when you call and you ordain and you equip, God. And so, Father, I pray that each and every day, Lord, as they're in the field, that, God, you'll continue to refresh them. You'll continue to rejuvenate them, Father God, meeting their needs according to your riches in glory, Father. And I pray that many souls, Lord, will be pointed to you through them, O God. And I ask that, Lord, you'll be honored, you'll be glorified. So meet their needs. Thank you for their praises, Father God. I bless you and I thank you. As a church, God, we are grateful.
Yeah.
We pray this in your name, Jesus, and all the church said,
amen.
Amen.
To just look wise,
but we were made to love the Lord. Yes, we were made to love the Lord. Love the Lord, love the Lord. We were made to love the Lord. That's what we were made for. Oh, we were made to love the Lord. Love the Lord.
Carry fleas,
but we were made to love the Lord. Yes, we were made to love the Lord. Love the Lord, love the Lord. We were made to love the Lord. That's what we were made for. Oh, we were made to love the Lord.
heart was broken, mine was mended. He became sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burden. The nails that held him set me free. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die, God's son would die to save a wretch
good song. What love divine. Tremendous. Acts with me this morning. The book of Acts in your Bibles, chapter number one. Oh, I hope your week's going great today. It's first day of the week, isn't it? I hope it's been good so far. Man, I've been encouraged just being in church. Our teens are competing all summer long, and I'm just encouraged by them memorizing the Bible, reading the Bible, doing chores without being asked, amen? Oh, it's great stuff. Man, then we get to come in here, we get to hear two great specials, we get to sing wonderful songs, Living for Jesus. Man, I hope you listen to the words of that song. Good stuff, His Life for Mine, Acts chapter number one. We're going to begin in verse number 1. We're going to read down to verse number 11 this morning. Acts chapter number 1, it says this, "The former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he is taken up, after that he thought the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion, by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven." Let's pray, and then we'll get into the Bible this morning. Lord, again, I'm just encouraged to be in your house this morning. Lord, I'm encouraged by the people this morning. Lord, it's been just a tremendous time just singing praises to you, hearing songs sung as a reminder of what great things you've done in my life. Lord, I'm so glad this morning just to be a part of the family of God. I'm thankful for my salvation. Lord, how you changed this wicked sinner, Lord, into what he is today, Lord. Still a sinner, but wholly leaning on Jesus' name. Lord, I pray this morning that you just empty me of myself. Lord, that whatever I say will be only from you this morning. Lord, I ask that you speak to hearts this morning as you see fit. Lord, move as only you can. Lord, pour out your spirit on us now. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, it's interesting, I would say a very difficult thing for us to do as individuals, not just as Christians, but just across the board. It's hard to do something. I'm going to say it. It's a four-letter word. I apologize. I don't even like to think about this word, but it's wait. Yeah. Right? We don't like to wait, right? Some of you couldn't even wait for me to say it. Right? We don't like it. Right? I have a 7-year-old son. He does not like the word wait. Right? I have a wife. She does not always like the word wait. Right? I have a puppy. I have a brand new 5-month-old puppy. She does not like wait. Right? And it's something that we all are familiar with, especially if we've been in any form of relationship, if we've been in any period of our lives, any phase of life that we go to, there are examples of, and we personally experience the fact that we don't like to wait. No. Right? We'll admit it. At least we should. Right? We don't like when somebody labels something and they tell us, wait. You shouldn't be able to tell me what to do, right? We live in an instant society. We live in instant gratification. My car doesn't even like to wait. I won't even have to push on the gas and it's all ready to go, right? Everything is here now. Let's get it done. I want this to happen even so right now. But Christ tells us all throughout scriptures we are to wait on him. We are to wait. Understand with me this morning that what God does in us during our periods of waiting is as important, right? It is just as important in our period of waiting as to what we are waiting for, right? It's so important for us to wrap our minds around the fact that waiting is beneficial to us. Right, we understand that as maybe you're rearing your children. Son, you need to wait right now. I don't want to wait. I want it right now. I think I should be able to eat this, brownie right now. It will ruin your meal. Right? The benefits that come from, guess what? Now you get the protein. Now you get the veggies. Now you get the vitamins. Now you get all the nutrients that you really need for life that you wouldn't have got from a brownie, right? And then ruined your supper. That's a dumb principle, right? But we're all familiar with it. Right, you need to wait for certain things in life and the benefits that come from waiting. Man, you don't eat right now, you're hungrier when it comes time to eat the actual food, right? Yeah. So then you eat more of what really should be good food at a meal. Yeah. Right? It's so important to understand waiting this morning. It requires patience. Our waiting requires patience. Patient trust. Right, we have to trust in him in whom we are waiting for. Understand the apostles here, the disciples, as they're watching Christ, as they're learning from him those 40 days after the resurrection. Right, verse number 4 says, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but, this is Christ speaking, wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. You need to wait for what God has promised in your life. What does that stem from? That's us trusting in what God is going to be doing. Right? They had to wait for what God was doing. Psalms 118, 8 through 14, it says, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations compassed me about, but in the name of the Lord will I destroy them. They compassed me about, yea, they compassed me about, but in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. They compassed me about like bees and are quenched as a fire of thorns, for in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. Thou hast thrust sore at me that I might fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and song and has become my salvation. There are benefits in waiting. He says we need to wait on the Lord. We need to trust in God more than we trust in those around us. You know, it's easy to desire that instant gratification, to push aside our patience because I so desire this to be done right now in my life. God, why aren't you doing this? What does that look like in modern society? Typically, it's, Lord, I need you to move a special way. What would that be? I don't know. I'm trying to establish a relationship. Lord, I fancy that person. I think she's splendid. Right? I think she's marvelous. That I want her in my life to be my beloved betrothed. Right? And there's that moment, and we're all familiar with a desiring maybe of a relationship. And it's easy for us to say, I need this relationship now, Lord. And to say, this woman is nice. I like her. She might not be the best for me, but I'm going to go and establish this relationship now. Right? God warns us all throughout Scripture, right? Not to be unequally yoked together. Be cautious, right? In those relationships, two are better than one. Right? Yes, in a relationship, a godly relationship, but they're also better at causing destruction and confusion and frustration. Right? Understand, trusting in God, we have to get to a point where our patience is put in God, not in those things around us. Oftentimes people will tell us, well, you should be able to get this right now. You've accomplished things in your life. You've gotten to a certain age. Right, we all go through that phase in life. Maybe we're getting ready to get out of our teen years. We're graduating high school. I should be able to have a nice car like mom and dad does. So I'm going to go out and I'm going to get my nice car. Instead of, saving maybe a little? Waiting for my career to be a little more established like mom and dad's is? Right, I'm going to go out and get a house. And then all of a sudden, bankruptcy? Right? Then all of a sudden, I didn't realize how much things cost. I didn't realize the expense nature behind all of these things that I really wanted. Right? Even the last few weeks, I've heard of a young man who's like, you are now responsible for your insurance. Yeah. Insurance for a 20-year-old is very expensive. I dare say around $300. right? That's what it was for me even. Right? And we get to this point, I should be able to get a car and get a license and I'm going to drive everywhere. I'm going to purchase my own vehicle. You just purchased yourself insurance too. So now not only did you want that nicer car with that nicer payment, but now that nicer car with the nicer payment comes with a nice price tag of insurance also. But then what do you need? Well, you need the gas to put in the car. Right? So you're going to have to work more hours at the job that you thought was going to be the best thing because you couldn't wait to work. And now you're making $10 an hour, paying $500 a month for a vehicle, $300 a month in gas, $300 a month in insurance. And now you're saying, wait a minute, I have to eat food. And I like food, if you don't know that. Okay, and it goes on and it goes on. Instead of, you know what, maybe God put my parents in my life or those role models in my life so I could look to them and I could say, okay, it is important for me to listen to them. Yeah. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Right? It's important for us to understand. I just told the teenagers this morning, you are in the training grounds of life. Yeah. The teenage years are the years that are going to mold you for what? After the teenage years. Yeah. Right, you're establishing, you're figuring out what you're really going to believe, what you're really going to do, what you're really going to accept. And in doing so, then you're established for when you're out on your own and you have to make those decisions for yourself. But it comes from, as a Christian, our patience and putting our trust in who God is. Saying, listen, I'm surrounded, right? The psalmist was saying, I'm surrounded by countries, by enemies, by all of these things, but I am going to trust you because that is where my trust is put. We need to put our trust in God before we even move. You know, in Deuteronomy chapter number 31, verse number 8, he gives us a good example. It says this, 31 verse number 8. It says, and the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. What does it say? And the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. We get so eager at times in our lives, our impatience, our neglect to just relying on God, and we're not trusting fully in the fact that God is with me. He's not going to leave me. He's not going to forsake me. And he desires, he wants to make sure that he is leading our paths, that he is directing our ways. I've mentioned my brother-in-law. He's lived with me and my wife for a while there, going through a rough patch. And he decided one day, and he came to us in the morning. He said, I am going to move out of state. I have a cousin. I'm going to move. He's going to get me a job. He said he could get me a job. I'm going to be making $23 an hour. It was around that. I'm going to be making over $20 an hour. I just need to get up there. He said, I can live with him. He said, he's going to get me the job. He said, he's going to help me with rent. He's going to give me discounted rent. He's going to. And I said, buddy, have you even prayed about it yet? Well, I just feel like I can do this. Okay, well, why don't you take a few days? Do nothing in haste. Why don't you take a few? Why don't you talk to a few people who God has put in your lives? Like, I don't know, your sister and me. Yeah. Hey, well, why don't you take a little bit of time? Why don't you take it easy? Just think things through. Trust in the fact that maybe it's not the best decision to jump into. By 8 o'clock that night, he said, "I'm moving." Yeah. I took him out. We sat down at a Denny's. Right, we sat there, we prayed. I said, buddy, I really don't think this is a wise decision. You don't know all the details. I was like, your cousin can't hire you. His boss has to. Has he talked to his boss? Well, I'm pretty sure he said they're really looking for people. I was like, what experience do you have? Well, they said they'll train me. How can you even afford to get there on gas? Well, I got a little bit and I think I can make it. How are you going to be able to... I can do this. And he decided to move before I would dare say God was ready for him to. Halfway there, he fell asleep at the wheel, ended up in the ditch. right? Totaled his truck. Spent a couple days in the hospital. Right? Ended up continuing and going to where he was going to stay. And his cousin said, no, you really can't stay with me. No, I'm not able to get you that job. No, and everything fell through. We get so impatient in life that we think, I'm making the best decision. There's a way that seemeth right unto a man. And the way there, and the end thereof is death, right? We have to be mindful of the fact, is this God or is this pride? Is this God or is this arrogance? Is this God's directing or is this me being impatient? Understanding our patience, what God is trying to establish, what God is trying to show us, he knows what he's doing. God knows what he's doing. Right? And we get so impatient. I don't want to think that you know what you're doing, God. What does that look like in our own lives? Parents? Hey, this is what you need to do. Dad, you don't know what you're talking about. Mom, you don't know what you're talking about. Right? You're like, no, just trust me. I know what I'm doing. I've been there. I've dealt with that. I know the best route for you to take. And it's okay for us as parents to criticize and to get onto our children because I told you so, kids. But when God tells us so, we're like, no, that's not it. That wasn't God. That was. Be careful. We have to be so mindful in our waiting that to understand the patience that requires is letting God go before me and knowing that he knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing. You know what our waiting does? It should help us recognize our authority. God. It should help us. In my waiting times, I should recognize the authority in my life. I should understand something. When I am in a waiting period, I am not in charge. That's a hard one. Especially every adult in here is like, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm not in charge in reference to God. He knows the plans that he has for me. He knows the things that he desires for me. He knows the routes that I should take. And he's established them already if I just trust in him, if I just follow his leading. Right? We understand Ecclesiastes 3 says, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. There are periods of time. There is a time for every single thing and understanding that God has already established those things. He knew that we would be born as babies, not as old men. He knew that we would mature and grow and age through our lives instead of decrease and go down to a little baby. So that's just weird. Yeah, but God could have had it the other way. Right? I mean, he could have established it however he wanted to. But he knows there's a time to be born. There's a time to die. There's a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. There's a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, a time to refrain from embracing, a time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. There's a time for everything that you are going to be dealing with in your life, and you just need to realize the ultimate authority is not on you, it's on God. He wants to direct. He wants to lead. He wants to encourage. Galatians chapter 4, verse number 4 says, but when the fullness of the time was come, God, right? God sent his son. right? Made of a woman under the law to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. What's he saying? When the time was come, God being in control, understanding there will be periods of waiting, he understood when the time was come, he performed his will. Man did not perform God's will for him. God allowed, God saw fit. God sent forth his son. You know, there's an interesting period of time from Malachi to Matthew, it's like 400 years, where we really don't have any clue what God was doing. The people were just waiting. You know what was being established? It's interesting when you look back through history, what takes place is somebody that had great in their title, conquered the world. We call everybody the GOAT nowadays, but really the only great is somebody who can conquer everything, right? Right, Alexander the Great, he comes in, he conquers everything, he establishes his rule. What happens? He unifies language, right? So what happens then? The Hebrew text, the Old Testament was able then to be translated, and they were able to have copies in Greek, right? The roads were established. Right, things began to take shape and to form. And then all of a sudden, when the time had come, now what? God makes his son present, and guess what? People now have access. People can understand. People can write letters. People can communicate the goodness of Jesus Christ and the salvation he brings to everybody. When we're waiting, God's still working. We have to understand, right? We get in this mindset that when God is silent, he must not be present. That is so false. That is the most inaccurate statement I've ever heard. Right? When God is silent, he's either what? Preparing what you're waiting for, or he's trying to prepare you for what you're waiting for. The thing that you're waiting for could already be ready, but you still got some things to work out. There's still some things that God is trying to establish in your life that you're unwilling to let go of. You're not willing to get right. You're not willing to whatever, give it over to God. He's saying it's right there waiting for you if you just get ready. Or it's you're ready for it, and God's saying that is not quite ready for you yet. What do we like to tell the young people? Listen, pray for your future spouse. Pray for your future spouse. I know parents in here are praying for their children's future spouses. If you don't, as a parent or grandparent, you should be. Right? It's important. Right? So what does that mean? In the waiting period, my 7-year-old is not ready to be married. I know it's shocking, but he's not. But what does that mean? He's currently in a waiting period for the day that he will be. Does he even think about it? No. Right? He could care less. But what does that mean in this period of time? God is preparing a young lady for him. Right? And he has to be prepared, and she has to be prepared. Right? My wife had a little journal thing that she wrote, right, in her waiting period. And what that was, it was a list of things that she wanted and she prayed for in her future husband. No, I'm not 100%. But I got close. I was never an A student anyway, amen? I got about a 97. She's like, yeah, I think so. Right, but there were specific things. She wanted somebody who was taller, somebody who was blonde and blue-eyed. She wanted somebody, she wanted these things, and guess what? She prayed for them. But what happens? We get so eager in life. When I was a young man, I wanted to be married and have a family. That's what I wanted. I was like 13, I was like, I'm ready to be a dad. Yeah, I know, hilarious, right? But honestly, I just wanted a family. I wanted a family. I was like, this is what I'm gonna have, like 5 or 6 kids. I'm gonna be married. By the time I'm like in my early 20s, 20, 21, I'll already have a kid. That's just what I thought. Goes to show you what, what my thoughts would do, yeah? No, that's just what I wanted. But what happens? I was so impatient. I didn't recognize God's in control of this thing. So I jumped into it. I'm not in charge of my relationship. God should be. What happens? Relationships fail. We say, God, I just want a relationship. He's like, I'm not going to give you that because you're asking of your own lusts. You're not asking for my desire for your life. And finally, when I got my head right, I came to myself. I said, Lord, if you want me to be single, I'll be single. If you want me to find somebody, I'll find somebody. And there she was. Right? And it was wonderful in God being in charge when the time was right, said, this is now your wife. It's important for us to recognize the authority. I am not God. Amen. You are not God. Amen. Right? We cannot take that upon ourselves. Everything comes from Him. Everything in life. Right? We have to understand that. We have to understand that God wants us to be aware in our waiting that He is God and in control. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. James 1:17. Right? Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, which whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Everything that we so desire, God is willing to give us as long as it's in accordance with His will for our lives. As long as we're willing to wait on Him. As long as we're willing to be patient, to accept the fact that sometimes waiting is required. Waiting is something that God desires for each and every one of us. 2 Peter chapter number 1, 3 and 4 says, according as His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Everything is from God. We can establish, we can rely on, we can trust that He's in control, trust in His timing. You know, Abraham and Sarah, they waited 25 years to hold their baby. 25 years. Joseph, he had dreams and visions from God that he would rule, and he had to wait 13 years, most of which were spent in jail for something he didn't do. Right? There's a woman with the issue of blood who dealt with that for 12 years. Just waiting to touch the hem of Christ. She had to deal with that, trusting in who it was that was in charge. There was a man crippled from birth. He waited over 30 years for Christ to come by and say, pick up your mat. There are periods of waiting, and in that, we have to recognize who is in control. When we recognize who's in control, our waiting becomes less of a burden and more of an opportunity. Waiting allows God to work. It allows God to work. When we are waiting for things in life, it's allowing God to do things behind the scenes that we don't even know about, that we can't know about because it's God and His work. Right? We understand, right? Ye ask and receive not because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. Right? Oftentimes, our waiting periods are things that we are just greedy about. Lord, I want this in my life. And He's like, I'm not giving you that. You're not ready for the relationship because you're just being prideful and greedy about it. You're not ready for the new job position because you're just being prideful and greedy about it. You're not ready for the new house. You're not ready for the new car. You're not ready. Wait. Where you go, nope, I'm going to do it myself. God, I'll do it myself. And oftentimes it ends in destruction, doesn't it? Right? Those are the moments. Those are when things fall apart. Those are when the most frustrating times happen because we're impatient. When I wanted to move out, I was ready to move out, I thought. Right? 3 days after I graduated high school, I was out of that house and I wasn't even home for those 3 days. I stayed at my friend's house. Right? I came home, grabbed some boxes, moved out. I was not ready. But I thought I was. Because I'm a grown man, I'll do what I want. I graduated 3 days ago. I'm a man now. It was a joke. Right? What happens? Man, you're working crazy hours just because you're trying to pay rent, pay insurance, pay the bills, pay for food. A lot of hungry nights. A lot of ramen noodles. Homemade fish tacos. Stale hard shell tacos. Old fish sticks with a little bit of ketchup on it. I was living classy. Right? It's crazy because I wasn't willing to allow God to work in my life. I knew what I should have been doing after high school. I should have been going to Bible college because that's where God wanted me. I should have been following Him with my life because that's where God wanted me. I should have been ready for God to use me. But I wasn't allowing God to work. The waiting that I was experiencing, I was not satisfied in because I wasn't trusting Christ in it. We have to understand waiting produces great things in our life. You know, our waiting often will build strength. It will build character and strength. When we learn to wait, I bring up our nephew a lot that we basically adopted, and we're proud of that young man, right? And even as a teenager, I mentioned it a few weeks ago, he would save for things. He was willing to wait. That was the characteristic that I was proud of most of the time. Right? I'm going to buy a PlayStation. How are you going to afford it? I'm going to save my money. And what would he do? Sorry, friends, I can't come over. Sorry, I can't go to the movies tonight. Sorry, I can't go out for ice cream. I'm saving my money for a PlayStation. He's like 14. Who does that? Right? But he understood what that was. It was building some integrity in his life. So then as an adult, when he moved out of our house, what he was able to do is like, hey, yeah, I'm tight on my budget. I'm not doing anything. I'm not going out to my friend's house. I'm not doing these things. As an adult, he was able to say those things. You know what I was doing when I moved out of the house? Anything I wanted to. You know what happened when rent was due? I was stressing because I did anything I wanted to, and I had no money. It builds character. It builds strength. We have to understand in our waiting, God is performing and doing things that we have no clue about to benefit us in ways that we could never imagine. Psalms 27, verse 14, it says, wait on the Lord, be of good courage. And what? And he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. It's hard. Don't worry, you'll get stronger. It's difficult to wait. Don't worry, have a little bit of courage. Make a decision. You know what courage is? Confronting things that are difficult, right? Courage is not a lack of fear. It's just the ability to confront fearful things. Hey, have some courage in this. It's hard to wait for things. I know you're greedy. I know you're lustful. I know you're prideful and you think that you deserve this right now. Just wait. Easy. Right? We think of that little puppy. Wait. Wait. No, wait. Okay, get it. Right? There's that time when the reward comes and man, the excitement that comes from waiting. But it's allowing us to build that strength and reliance on who God truly is. There comes a time. There comes a time if we just wait where God says, go get it. He wants us to experience good things. He wants us to experience great and marvelous things. Isaiah 40, 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. It's building the strength that we have, the reliance on God. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and faint not. As our strength builds in those periods of waiting, as our reliance on God, as our character is focused on who God is in our lives and what he desires for our past to be, what happens is in those moments when he says, go ahead, get it, man, it's like a burden's gone. We just soar. It's a wonderful thing that God so desires for our lives. In Acts chapter number 1, when the apostles are waiting and they're trying to just wrap their heads around this fact, right? Those two individuals clothed in white raiment, they're sitting there and they're saying, "Why are you just standing here gazing?" Waiting requires us to work on things. Our patience, our understanding of our authority, yeah. Right? Our waiting and building, allowing God to work, building our strengths and reliance on Him. Our waiting produces great things if we just wait on God. And He's saying, guess what? While you're waiting for God, don't just sit there. Right? I think this is where a lot of Christians fall into a dangerous area because, well, I'm waiting on God to come back, so we'll just sit here and wait. And He says, no, there's work to do. There are things that we have to accomplish in waiting for God. You know what? While we're waiting for Christ to return, maybe it is that His return is already ready, but He's waiting for some of us to get ready for it. Some of us need to grow. Some of us need to mature. Some of us need to better prepare. Some of us need to better work. Recognize His authority. Realize who He is in our lives. Some of us need to do those things. But it could be He's just not ready to come yet. It's in His timing. It's in His timing. You know what it takes? It takes a reliance on God, a trust and a faith for us to wait. You know, it's difficult to trust and wait on something that you don't experience in your own lives. Oftentimes, I think we get into these habits as Christians to where I'm not reading my Bible, I'm not praying, and that is what ultimately will lead to a lot of impatience and a lot of dissatisfaction and a lot of eagerness to just accomplish things when something's presented. Right? Because the nourishment, right? The leading that God is trying to offer is not present there. Right? It's been said this, and it's somewhat understandable, and I'm not criticizing, but understand oftentimes those who maybe don't bring their Bibles to church is a good indication that they're probably not reading it at home. Right? Maybe it's an indication that those who don't serve in church aren't really concerned about what God desires for their life. Maybe they're indications that we get so caught up because we're impatient. I don't want to wait for God to do things. I'm going to accomplish things myself, so I'm going to leave God out of it. We got to be careful. As Christians, we got to be mindful of the fact that our waiting is something that God has established for us to do because everything should come by His timing. Right? Maybe it is that you've never accepted Christ as your Savior and you don't understand waiting on God. You don't understand that precious gift that He offered through salvation, through His crucifixion on the cross, the blessed life that He provides through His sacrifice. You say, my life, I'm always impatient. I'm always greedy. I'm always lustful. Maybe you don't know Christ this morning. Maybe you never accepted Him as your Lord and Savior. And you need to come. You say, Lord, I trusted You. I want to follow You with my life. Please help me live for You. Maybe we as Christians need to come forward as well and say, Lord, whatever You have for my life, help me to follow You. Help me to wait on You. On who You are. He's a good God. And He wants to bless us. He wants to give us great and mighty things. In His time. In His time. Let's pray. We'll be dismissed. Lord, just thank You so much for Your goodness. Lord, through our periods of waiting, I pray that we just learn to rely on who You truly are. Lord, You're in control. You are the final authority. Lord, help us to place our trust and strength in the only one who can truly give us strength. Lord, I pray for those individuals here this morning who may be struggling with a little bit of impatience, or maybe those who are struggling just relying on who you are in their life. Lord, wait is a hard word to accept at times. Lord, I pray for those individuals who may not know you as their Lord and Savior. Lord, only you know the heart. Maybe there's somebody here this morning who does not know for certainty that they're going to heaven when they die. I pray they get that settled before they leave. Lord, be with this time of invitation now. We ask you to bless it. In Jesus' name, amen.